Okay, I'd like to start with saying thank you to organizers for organizing this beautiful meeting and for inviting me to the Gillis talk. In fact, the main picture which I will discuss today is not new, and it is based on a joint paper with Eva Sachs. In 2001, and we call it horizon holography, and that would be another, well, maybe a better title for my talk. So we'll start with reviewing the known examples of holographic description. The standard one, ADS CFT, then De Sitter, Minkowski, and finally, the main subject of my talk, horizon CFT. So ADS CFT, well, is the gold standard example of holographic description. Well, in general, in holographic description, well, idea is, as you well know, that we can describe physics in the bulk by some data specified on a boundary. That boundary is usually called as holographic screen. And in known examples of holographic description, this data is organized in the form of conformal field theory. So the first and the main example of this holographic description is ADS CFT. And we consider asymptotic ADS metric. So Y is sort of radial direction. L is a radius. This L is the radius of anti-De Sitter. So when Y goes to infinity, that's the leading behavior of the metric. And what stands here is a metric on d-dimensional boundary. So our CFT is supposed to live here and has a dual description in terms of gravity on anti-De Sitter. So scalar field, so any excitation on anti-De Sitter, for instance, scalar field, I apologize, I will spend some time telling you very known facts, but I will use them later. So scalar field will mass M, assuming that phi behaves as exponential of h y l. We find an equation for h, which is of that form. And from here we find two solutions, h plus and h minus. So one value h plus is positive, h minus is negative. So one mode is growing, sorry, it's minus. The other mode is decaying. And well, for large y, we have two, we have an expansion. In ADS-FT dictionary, this mode describes a source on the boundary, and that field would be expectation value of a dual operator. So in order to reconstruct, well, this field in the bulk, we have to specify both the source and the expectation value. I have minus on both. Simply h minus is negative, h plus is positive. So similar story exists for gravity. Assuming that metric in the bulk satisfies Einstein equations with negative cosmological constant, we have well-known Pfeiffer-Mann-Graham expansion. Well, that metric, well, is expanded in Y. Well, there are some subleading terms plus U minus L. In this expansion, two terms are not determined, the boundary metric and this term. This second term has interpretation as expectation value of boundary stress energy tensor. It can be also thought as a proportional to extrinsic curvature of the boundary, of regularized boundary. And in order to reconstruct metric in the bulk, we have to specify both the metric and the expectation value of stress energy tensor. The conformal symmetry on the boundary is a part of conformal symmetry is generated on the boundary is generated by bulk diffeomorphism. So I use coordinate rho instead of y here. And xa rho is alpha x. And xa I, well, satisfies certain equation, which can be, it can be determined in powers of rho. And under this diffeomorphism, the boundary metric can transform conformally. So that's the standard story in ADS-CFT. If you want do similar analysis in the Sitter spacetime, well, one way is to do analytic continuation for L squared, so L to IL, and also Y to IT. And the Sitter spacetime is a, well, it looks like that. That's global time tau. And in this case, we have two boundaries at tau minus infinity and tau plus infinity. So each section of the Sitter space is a surface, sorry, is a sphere. And well, in this picture, Strominger in 2001, we can associate to each two surfaces conformal operators, which satisfy the usual conformal correlation functions. And well, in this case, if you look here, if you do analytic continuation L squared to minus L squared, there is minus here, and H plus has an interpretation in the dual in the conformal theory as a conformal conformal dimension, and may become imaginary if mass is sufficiently large. So that is one problem. The second problem that, well, if you want to describe quantum evolution on the Sitter spacetime, in principle, we could describe this evolution in terms of correlation functions between operator here and operator there. But any single observer will not have access to all data which is specified on each sphere. So that sort of evolution would not be observable. Any observer will not have access to the whole information on the screens. Well, similar story exists for Fifferman-Graham expansion. By the way, in this case, it was for the Sitter spacetime. It was discovered by Starobinsky completely independently in 1993. So in these two examples, anti-de Sitter and de Sitter, conformal theory lives on a codimension one hypersurface. In my next example, conformal theory will live on codimension two hypersurface. Well, this picture was suggested in our paper with Jan de Boer in 2003. So now we are in Minkowski spacetime. Cosmological constant is zero. And we look at light cone. Take any light cone. So then inside light cone, we can slice space-time with hyperbolic slices. So here, space-time looks like that. Space-time metric minus dt squared plus t squared. And here, metric of hyperbolic space. So t goes that way. And outside the light cone, we can slice it with de Sitter slices. So here metric, flat metric looks like d r squared plus r squared metric of de Sitter. Yes. And all the slices have same boundary. Well, actually, two boundaries. That sphere and the second sphere, so that would be s minus d, s plus d. An idea is to relate, well, consider the dual-layer standard holography on each slice here on layer. And these two spheres would be two holographic screens where all data, conformal data are defined. So if we start with, as an example, scalar field of mass m, then suppose I look at here outside, look at solution to this equation outside light cone. So I assume this behavior. Sorry, theta, yeah, x. Then this field phi, okay, phi lambda, will satisfy massive scalar field equation with certain mass on the anti-de Sitter slice. And mu is related to lambda. And what is interesting, if you look at propagating modes are plane waves. Then these modes are described by complex lambda. Complex lambda, and respectively, if you now compute conformal weights for let mass using let expression, you will find that correspondingly conformal operators have a complex. So in this description. In this description, the propagating waves, plane waves, are described by conformal operators defined at the Heo layer with complex conformal weights. Well, there is ongoing research. Yes.
What does the holographic screen
seek
in the Penrose diagram?
Well, on Penrose diagram, I guess that would be my light cone, and that would be this sphere.
So you take special points on Sky Plus and Sky Minus?
Yeah.
Which depend on the origin?
It depends on the origin, where I put this point. So I can, of course, move this origin, and that will generate certain symmetry on my sphere. In particular, I will have generators of BMS group generated on that sphere.
And you don't have to consider this codimension one, the whole codimension one object.
I could, but all these slices have same boundary, and it's more economic define data here.
If you move this point, you expand the whole. I would have thought that this the holography has to play with the full sky plus and sky minus. If it exists.
Well, in this picture, it's like that. We pick.
You pick one point.
I pick.
See, in the other example, you didn't pick any special observer. Here you're showing the past and future light cones of a given observer.
It is, yes. It is attached to this particular observer which goes that way. Well, there is some ongoing research on of two groups. One group by Strominger and the other by Sandrum, which are building on this picture. Well, in particular, in the paper by Sandrum, they have so in principle we could decode S matrix in terms of correlation functions, conform correlation functions defined on these spheres. And they have a one-to-one correspondence, which was already anticipated in our paper, between endpoint correlation function and scattering amplitude. So if you have any and vice versa, it's invertible.
Scattering amplitude of massless field?
Massless fields and also massive. Massive are more difficult to describe. That is true. Well, we considered massless fields, and but there is also there should be description for massive fields. There is similar construction for massive fields. Okay, and now I will. The statement.
Quantum gravity on Minkowski space.
Well, we didn't consider quantum gravity. We just look at simplest scalar field. So for scalar field, the statement is that quantum evolution, or if you like, scattering in Minkowski spacetime, can be represented as sort of correlation functions between conformal operators defined on these two spheres.
So do you speak of a very particular sphere on sky minus in
particular? That is true. So suppose I send a wave packet from here and detect wave packet there. And always there is a, well, it's not necessarily peaked at this point, but there will be a tail which can be detected at that point.
But I mean, why doesn't it depend, why not, what's up in scribe plus at that sphere? Why doesn't it depend on the whole of scribe minus or a big part of scribe minus and not just that? I mean, I don't see how you get a unique mapping from this one sphere on scry minus to this one sphere on scry plus. Doesn't what happens in scry plus depend on other places in scry minus rather than just that one and two sphere?
You mean that it may depend on the point, point.
I mean, suppose you have the field that's on this two surface on scry plus.
Right.
Does that depend on the field? Not just on the on that particular two sphere on scry minus, doesn't it depend on the whole distribution of the scalar field on scry minus?
Yeah, like if you send in two particles, the result will depend on the impact parameter, or the relative impact parameter. There will be
gravitational
shift.
Same point on scry plus or scry minus, it's just the sphere on the conformal sphere.
So, I mean, this picture with wave packets, you don't like it?
I think if you send a single particle, then the picture is correct. But if you have interactions in the bulk.
If it doesn't interact, then it'll just go yeah, straight across. That's right.
Okay, but let me continue. Is near horizon optical metric. Uh, Let's take any static D plus two dimensional metric. And well, I use like function f, which describes a killing horizon at some point. So it is conformal to what is called optical metric. And f of r has a simple root. Has a simple root, and beta h is related to inverse temperature. And that metric is called optical metric. Okay. So now, because, well, I introduce here y, and y is related to coordinate r like this. So near horizon r minus rh is proportional to exponential minus 2y over beta h, and f of r is proportional to minus 2y over beta h, and this factor. So r squared over f of r is proportional to some constant c exponential to y over beta h. And we see that asymptotically, if y goes to infinity, so y goes to infinity, r goes to r h. Y approaches horizon, this metric is actually hyperbolic D plus one dimensional metric. So universally near horizon, in the optical metric, we have the product of r1 and hd plus 1. So it is universally, but only to leading order. And y goes to infinity. Metric horizon is a D sphere. In optical metric, it becomes boundary of horizon. Of this hyperbolic space. And beta h, this inverse Hawking temperature, is a radius of HD hyperbolic space. So the statement that this behavior is only to leading order in Y, but there is one example when
it is so to all orders in Y, to all values of Y. And that's exactly when our space-time is the sitter. So when space-time is the sitter, R squared of F is that. So L, the sitter radius is beta H. And, well, optical metric is minus dt squared plus metric of anti-de Sitter. Well, if no, pure de Sitter, pure de Sitter, pure de Sitter. So consider scalar field. So consider scalar field on this original initial metric, which describes a black hole. We redefine phi. Okay, phi optical. And then this phi optical will satisfy, well, sort of massive equation in optical metric. Optical, where m squared, well, mass effectively becomes y dependent, and there are several terms. So mass is just multiplied by f, and there are also terms which don't depend on m. They simply come due to this multiplication. The leading term, first term, is u4 squared n plus other terms which vanish if f is zero. So now when y goes to infinity, that becomes zero, and that becomes minus d over 2 beta h squared. So looking at solution with particular frequency, phi optical omega t, we find that this phi omega satisfies equation on anti-de Sitter, phi omega, where this effective mass in linear horizon region is a combination of two terms, minus omega squared and minus d over 2 beta h squared. So now again, we look at this formula, and we see that if you compute conformal weights, they become complex. D over 2. And phi omega has two modes, respectively with h plus and h minus. In fact, I can play similar game for interacting fields. So So I add some self-interaction. So phi n minus 1. So let in Lagrangian, that would be phi n. So I do exactly the same trick. I rewrite everything in optical metric. Then phi optical, you satisfy, well, similar equation, but now coupling constant becomes y dependent. And it's multiplied by certain power of function f. So for certain values of n, of this n, lambda y is decreasing. For other values, it is increasing. So if n is less than 2 plus 4 over d, lambda y goes to 0. So n equals 2 plus 4 over d. Lambda y is y independent, and n larger than 2 plus 4 over d, lambda y goes to infinity. Well, while I prepared this talk, I discussed this point with Gary, and he suggested that maybe there is a this condition singles out renormalizable theory. And this seems to be the right intuition. So in this case, lambda has a positive mass dimension that would be zero and negative. So renormalizable scalar field near horizon effectively massless. So mass will disappear, and it's also free. So lambda switches off asymptotically when we approach horizon. So now we can continue the same path and identify conformal operators. So when y goes to infinity, phi optical can be represented as by this integral. Well, let's basically left and right moving modes near horizon. That would be left moving, and what would be right moving modes. And respectively, Green's function. So Green's function on optical metric. When both y and y prime go to infinity can be decomposed on Green's function . So that would be Green's function on anti-de Sitter satisfying that equation. Oops. So we consider that behavior, form of the scalar field as boundary condition near horizon. And as usual, we put we compute on-shell action on a solution to wave equation, which is functional of this boundary data. Take two variations, and we get correlation functions for dual conformal operators. So gamma is the distance, geodesic distance on the sphere. So we have two points. That would be gamma, geodesic distance. And for these are two operators related to left moving and right moving modes, but on the correlation function of same type operators. Will produce delta function. And what is interesting is, there is a dependence on the frequency here in the correlation function. And this factor, this function contains conformal, thermal factor. Well, I should probably say also that conformal symmetry, again, we can play similar game as in anti-de Sitter. Conformal symmetry is generated by bulk bulk diffeomorphism. So we take, we generalize this metric. We put here conformal factor. So in asymptotically, when rho goes to zero, in now horizon at rho equals zero, this metric should approach metric of anti-de Sitter. So we have a decomposition for sigma in jij plus some corrections. Plus some rho corrections proportional to rho. And induced metric on the horizon is multiplied by E sigma over rho G zero. And again, we look at, as in the case of anti-de Sitter, we look at diffeomorphism, which preserve the formula at metric. And that would be, generated by vector xa. So xa t is just constant. Xa rho is alpha of x. And xa I, in the similar way as in anti-de Sitter case, can be determined by rho expansion in rho. under this diffeomorphism, sigma is changing by alpha, alpha x, respectively g0 is changing. And the induced metric is, of course, invariant. There is a generalization of this diffeomorphism when xt is not constant but linear nt, and that diffeomorphism will effectively rescale beta h or Hawking temperature. Well, to leading order is just usual conformal transformation. You mean?
It's a finite. You don't get functions. You just
get we do get functions. So this xi is expansion in Rho. And we get this expansion.
How many parameters?
Just one. So it's this function alpha of x.
So it's an infinite number?
Infinite. So it's like in an anti de Sitter.
So you get like Virasoro or you get infinite?
Well, in this case, this is conformal transform rescaling on d-dimensional sphere. So if d is 2, we get Virasoro. So like in 4D, sphere would be two-dimensional, it will get Virasoro. Let me just, can we reconstruct metric? Well, I already raised the anti de Sitter case. So in anti de Sitter, we could fix the metric on the boundary, conformal boundary, and stress energy tensor on the boundary, and that would give us, using this data, we could reconstruct the whole metric in the bulk. So can we play a similar game here? So in fact, we use same metric. Oops. So we use this metric. All this form, we fix sigma zero, we fix g zero, and suppose little whole metric satisfies Einstein equations in the bulk with possibly non-trivial cosmological constant, and we look at static solutions, so described by this metric, and then we'll find, so we fix sigma zero, gij zero, as our data, boundary data, and then all these terms in this expansion for sigma and for gij are completely determined. So sigma 1, sigma 2, and so on, so respectively g1, g2, and so on, are completely determined by this by this data. So in this game, gij zero should not be necessarily a metric of around sphere. It can be more or less any metric. And but of course, this solution, if you continue it far from horizon, will not be asymptotically flat, asymptotically Minkowski, and that means that this solution, this matrix will not violate this uniqueness theory theorem by Werner Israel.
Did you have some gauge condition to fix the problem when you go away from the horizon?
Gauge condition, you mean?
Like a Pfeffer-Mangan coordinate or something to fix the...
That's my gauge condition. I use this form for the metric. Yeah, it's everywhere. I assume that metric, this metric takes this form. I put it in bulk Einstein equations, solve it iteratively as expansion in row, and find that all terms in this expansion are uniquely determined by these two data. So let me finish with.
Sorry, can you get the analog of the angular potential?
No. That's a very good point. I don't get any analog of stress energy tensor.
The component theory has no annealing potential?
Well, let me say why. Because, potentially stress energy tensor would be extensive curvature. So like first term in this expansion. So it starts from rho squared. First term in this expansion would be extensive curvature, and extensive curvature vanishes on the horizon. It's sort of property of horizons. And that's why we don't have the second tensor or stress energy tensor.
So the CFT would have continuous spectrum of operator, complex dimensions, and no elemental tension.
Yeah.
So it's very exotic.
Well, it is exotic, yeah. But, let me finish with some idea or proposal. So how we could define, I don't know, S matrix on the Sitter space. So let's take a causal patch of the Sitter. So it's D plus two. So that would be a word line of an inertial observer. It has past horizon, it has future horizon. And that causal diamond is all this observer can see. So it has access to the whole data. In principle, then everything what comes in this region comes from here. What leaves goes there. Respectively, these are ingoing modes are described by some conformal operators. These modes by other conformal operators. Okay, out. And quantum evolution in this patch could be, well, using this technique, can be encoded in correlation functions, conformal correlation functions. And similar structure in asymptotically flat space-time with horizon. So we have, well, past horizon here, future horizon there. So these modes, incoming and outgoing modes near horizon can be described by this effectively, by conformal operators. And, well, that would presumably give us some idea how to prescribe quantum evolution in this case. So let me stop here.
Your calculations seem to show that for a non-renormalizable theory, things are very different, right? I mean, your nice formula here for C of omega, for example.
Yes, well, for non-renormalizable theories, n is larger than that number, lambda is lambda is increasing function of y, and it blows up near horizon. That means we cannot do perturbation theory in this case. So in this case, in this sense, renormalizable theories are nice, because, well, here and there, theory is free, and we have well-defined asymptotic states here and there, which is not the case in for non-renormalizable theories.
Any other question before the break?